Hachette Audio presents Run Forever, Your Complete Guide to Healthy Lifetime Running. Written by Amby Burfoot. Read by Chris Ciulla. This program contains a bonus PDF. This book is dedicated to all my running teachers and mentors, particularly John J. Kelly, and also to the many great athletes, coaches, and scientists who have shared their running knowledge with me through the last 50-plus years. Introduction. Running is the simplest of sports. It deserves a simple book. That's why I wrote Run Forever. In the last 25 years, running has grown massively popular and increasingly complex. There are too many shoes, drinks, energy bars, training plans, stretching devices, massage tools, and books willing to dissect and discuss all of them. I'm here to say the opposite. Running is not complicated. Run Forever doesn't attempt to explain everything there is to know about running. It explains only what you need to know. It drills down to the essentials. I've organized Run Forever in a clear and easy-to-follow manner. There are just six main sections: getting started, nutrition for runners, going farther, dealing with injuries, getting faster, and running forever. Even though it contains a training plan for half marathons and marathons, which some might consider the ultimate running challenges, going farther precedes getting faster. Both require consistency and determination. But getting faster is the harder of the two, because it also demands specialized workouts and true grit. Each section contains 10 to 12 chaplets, as I call them. These provide short, concise summaries of key information and conclude with at least three direct actions to follow. Everything you'll read on these pages has emerged from my half-century of running experience, the testimony of the world's best runners and coaches, and the scientific conclusions of top running researchers. At the personal level, I've road-tested every piece of advice in Run Forever. Over the last 55 years, I've run 110,000 miles, more than enough to make lots of mistakes, bad for me, and figure out better ways, good for you. Once, I was fast. I was fortunate enough to win the Boston Marathon in 1968 and to run a 2:14 that year. Now, I'm slow. I'm a happy member of the back-of-the-pack gang, and I'm proud to be there. I finished the same Thanksgiving Day 5-miler 55 years in a row. A few days after this book is due to be published, I hope to complete the Boston Marathon on the 50th anniversary of my win in 1968. Along the way, I've run marathons with Will Ferrell and Oprah Winfrey. If they can do it, and both did, finishing their races impressively, so can you. Many friends helped me write this book. In 4 decades of work at Runner's World magazine, I had long discussions with hundreds of elite runners. Frank Shorter, Bill Rogers, Catherine Switzer, Greta Weitz, Joan Benoit Samuelson, Dina Castor, Mev Keflezighi, Ryan Hall, Shalane Flanagan, and more. Their wisdom and insight is woven throughout Run Forever. I also have a consuming interest in sports science, and I've interviewed many of the leading lights of the last half century: Ken Cooper, David Kostel, Ralph Paffenbarger, James Freese, Jack Daniels, Tim Noakes, Stephen Blair, and more. Their evidence-based findings underlie the most important concepts of Run Forever. My high school coach and mentor. Section 1. Getting Started. Essay. My first horrid run. My first long-distance run was one of my worst, maybe the worst ever. It came as a form of punishment. Too many runners get their start this way. It's all wrong. Indeed, it's no doubt the main reason so many stop running: an initial, painful introduction to the sport. I hope you'll find a different way. In fact, it's essential. If you don't organize your running as a positive part of your days and weeks, you won't continue it for long. I was lucky, as you'll learn in a moment. You might not be so fortunate. In that case, you'll need to discover ways to create your own luck, to surround your running with many positive reinforcements. I grew up the son of a YMCA director. He introduced me to all the popular sports, primarily football, basketball, and baseball. And I played them all with a wide-eyed energy and enthusiasm. I like to think I was pretty good, too. I grew nearly a foot in junior high school, reaching the 6-foot mark. That helped me choose my first high school sport. I decided to take a shot at basketball. It seemed a good fit. I had a burning desire to be a star athlete. I would do whatever it took. I tried out for the basketball team as a 10th grader. More scrappy than talented, I somehow managed to make the cut and was placed on the JV squad, at the very bottom of the squad. I was the worst player on the team. Even I could see that. Before this, in my inexperienced youth, I hadn't realized how many basketball players were stronger than me, not to mention better jumpers, better dribblers, better shooters, the whole works. The coach saw fit to put me in only one game. As I recall, we were behind by about 37 points with 2 minutes remaining. Coach figured it was safe to let me play at that point. There was nothing to lose. Not for the team, not for his personal reputation. Both were already scraping the bottom of the barrel. His assessment proved accurate. In my 2 minutes of play, I performed no miracles. That first season of JV basketball shocked me to my senses. I realized I hadn't reached the brink of athletic stardom, but didn't know where to turn next. At one practice, Coach grew particularly exasperated by our efforts. He threw up his hands in despair and ordered us off the court. As punishment, he told us to run the school's 3-mile cross-country course. "You guys aren't tough enough," he said. "Maybe cross-country can teach you a lesson or two." None of us were excited by the prospect, but what were we to do? I was the quiet, obedient type, so I set off at a dutiful pace behind my peers, the better basketball players. To my surprise, most of them were walking after a quarter mile. I kept going. It turned out that while I was the worst player on the basketball team, I was better than the others at running 3 miles. I'm not saying I enjoyed the run. Hardly. It was absolute torture, especially the 2 big hills on our high school's cross-country course. I struggled to keep running on the hills. My teammates walked. If our basketball coach intended to punish us with this workout, he succeeded. By the end, my face was caked with salt, and my thighs felt heavy as tree trunks. Worst of all, my feet were raw and blistered. To wear high-top basketball shoes on a cross-country run is a little like using a wooden matchstick to brush your teeth. You can get the job done, but you know that better equipment would make things much more pleasant. At any rate, I finished minutes before anyone else, and soon found myself calculating my sports skills. Did I want to be last in basketball, or take a chance at a new sport where I seemed to have some natural talent? I chose the latter. It made all the difference. I didn't meet my cross-country coach, John J. Kelly, until the first day of practice the following September. Still, everyone in my high school knew about Kelly. He was a Boston Marathon winner, 1957, 1959 Pan American Games marathon champ, 2-time U.S. Olympic marathoner, and still among the half dozen best marathoners in the country. I soon learned that these were the least of Kelly's accomplishments. More important, he was a brilliant, iconoclastic, unique individual, way ahead of his time. Kelly was a vegetarian, organic gardener, Bob Dylan fan, peacenik, ardent environmentalist, raconteur, student of great literature and philosophy, and believer in the essential goodness of all people, especially artists, freethinkers, and the downtrodden. I understood little about running at the time, but of course, it had a terrible reputation. Cross country was for skinny, weak, uncoordinated kids who couldn't catch or throw. Worse, it was tough, sweaty, boring, bone-wearying, soul-sapping, and completely unrecognized by newspapers and the sports-loving public. My school's cheerleading squad got more respect than we runners. I didn't care. I only wanted to be good at something. I was even willing to endure the endless tedium of interval training on a track, if that's what it took. In the early 1960s, When I joined Kelly's cross-country team, everyone did interval training, almost every day. Kelly wasn't everyone, however. He followed a different drummer. We never ran endless loops around the cinder track that circled the football field. Instead, he led us on romps through apple orchards, nearby parklands, and marshy trails at the edge of Long Island Sound. Kelly never spoke a word about how to run. I have no list of commandments that he proffered us. There were no quizzes. He just showed us how he ran, and we followed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.